Blackstone presents Funeral Train by Laurie Loewenstein. This book is read by Kelli Taker. To my mentor and friend, David Hollis. There's a little black train a-coming. Set your business right. There's a little black train a-coming, and it may be here tonight. Go tell that ballroom lady, all dressed in the worldly pride, that death's dark train is coming. Prepare to take a ride. Traditional gospel song from the 1800s. Chapter 1. There was a railroad crossing out that way. The engineer cast out two long calls, then a short blast, then another. The thick cords vibrated across the plains. If there had been jalopies or farm wagons at the grade, they would have juddered to a stop. But this afternoon, only dust devils skittered across the rails. The train's desolate song suited the time and place. December 1935, smack in the crosshairs of the Great Depression and the Dust Bowl. Together, they had done their worst to this raggedy piece of the Oklahoma panhandle. Some farmers and merchants had packed up and deserted the meagerly populated high plains. Some had stayed, but shrank into themselves, ashamed of their collective poverty. The four-part whale bloomed, then faded, as the train rattled west. A farm wife was rolling out biscuits when she heard the engine's cry. She considered the chain of crowded cars embroidering the horizon, imagined them gently rocking as they traversed the crossing. The silhouetted passengers might be the only folks she saw for the remainder of the day. And what of the passengers? As they leafed through newspapers or dozed, the train's cautionary chords pacified them too. The engine's song implied safety, promising that accidents could be prevented and collisions averted. The passengers rearranged their legs. In this way, the folks inside the train and those standing at their kitchen windows took comfort in the train's song. But in fact, the chord was a warning that there might be danger ahead, a warning that all parties better take care. Sheriff Temple Jennings was driving back to town. In the distance, he heard that same westbound train blowing her horn at the crossing. Rubberized shadows of fence posts stretched from one side of County Road 15 to the other, flattening under the tires of the sedan in the late afternoon sun. Grit spattered the windshield. Temple cranked up the heater. He'd spent the afternoon crouched inside a ring of sage, staking out a brush-filled ravine. A local farm had called in a tip that morning about a whiskey still operating there. Generally, Temple didn't get too worked up about small-time moonshine operations. There was no way he could stamp out all of them and get any other work done. Most times, he took care of the issue by casually approaching a bootlegger and saying, "I hear you're farming in the brush." And the boilers, coils, mash barrels, and other apparatuses would vanish by nightfall. Whiskey and all other hard liquor were still illegal in Oklahoma, even though the federal government had repealed the 18th Amendment 2 years previous. In Oklahoma, beer was legalized, but that was it. People who wanted something stronger than suds had to buy their booze under the table, and there were a number of moonshiners happy to keep up with demand. If an operation got too big, Temple felt obligated to go after it, but it was part of the job that stuck in his craw. He relished a drop of the hard stuff as much as the next man, and tracking down and closing the operation was a thankless task. Take today, for instance. After 3 hours of surveillance, the only things moving in that gorge were tree sparrows and a couple of squirrels. Temple was left with nothing to show for his time but the numb fingers and stiff knees of a 56-year-old man. He'd put Ed, his young deputy, on an overnight watch. Neither middle-aged aches nor the fickle heater could bring Temple low today. His wife, Etha, was due home at nightfall after 6 days in St. Louis. Seemed mighty like 6 years. when she had brought up the idea of visiting her friend Lottie. Temple initially fancied the notion of temporary bachelorhood. In his mind's eye, this translated into shoving pie directly from the tin into his mouth, leaving the bedclothes tangled from one day to the next, shaving every other morning. But all that fun had quickly worn thin. He missed his wife. That evening, she'd step off the train and he'd embrace her mightily. Now, he saluted the afternoon express as it whizzed past. A sappy ballad trickled from the radio. Temple fingered the dial.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.